Good morning and welcome to FCC. If this is your first time tuning in with us, whether it's online or here in person, we are so excited you're here. Please go ahead and scan the virtual connection card so we can get to know you a little bit better and say hi. There are a few things I want to tell you before we get into our service today. You passed pre-portioned communion cups on your way in. If you didn't grab one, don't worry. During communion time, just raise your hand. Someone will be around to hand you your communion cup. When we get to our time of offering, you'll notice there are black boxes on the side of the stage and one back by the sound booth. If you prefer, you can actually give online at fcclive.net, or you can do your offering through the text to give in the Church Center app. July is a 5 Sunday month, and that's next week. Next week is our Sent to Serve, and we are so excited. We want to see you here so we can go out and serve the community at places like Brightside or the park or even our prayers and projects. So no matter what your physical ability is, there's going to be a way that you can serve the Lord here. Now go ahead and stand as we start our service.
Good morning, church. Our worship is in response to the scriptures, and this morning comes from Ephesians 6. Please read with me as loud as you can. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. I want this to be on our hearts this morning as we come into this time of worship, and as we enter into our sermon time. Let's just soak in this word from the Lord as we lift his name high.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey, forth to the mighty conflict in this his glorious day. Ye that are brave now serve him against unnumbered foes. Let courage rise with danger and strength to strength oppose. Stand up for Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him who overcometh, a crown of life shall be.
Take a moment and go around and greet your neighbor. Okay, let's return to our worship of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Onward, Christian soldiers. voices, loud your anthems raise. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war. With the cross of Jesus going on before. Onward then, ye people, join our happy throng. Lend with ours your voices in the triumph song. Glory, Lord, and honor unto Christ the King. This through countless ages, men and angels sing. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war. With the cross of Jesus going on before.
You can be seated. As we enter into this time of communion with God and His Son, I want us to reflect on the verse that we read prior to starting our service, that God does equip us for His evil schemes, for the Satan's evil schemes. But we must remember that Christ has already won the war. And that war, that battle, that was fought on the cross. But I also want us to dig a little deeper this morning as we come into this time of reflection and communion on what Jesus has done for us. That we just think of the crucifixion, horrible and unbearable. And then we go straight to the resurrection, which is joyous and triumphant and victorious. But those days in between, those silent days were not silent for the Lord. Christ battled things that we could not possibly fathom. He fought a war for us and won. I want that on our hearts this morning. Not just the victory of Jesus, but what He put into that for each and every one of us. As Jesus was reclining with His disciples at the table sharing a meal, just as we do now, He took the bread, He gave thanks, and He said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, taking the cup, He blessed it, gave thanks, and said, "This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." As we gather this morning, let us remember not only Jesus the Savior, but Jesus the Warrior. God, you sent Jesus to battle the battles that I could not. He fought and He was victorious. God, we're gathering this morning to remember not only the victory, but the battle and what Jesus went through for each and every one of us, so undeserving. But God, you sent Him in love, in grace and mercy. A justification for who you are and who you continue to be. A great and loving God. Thank you for this time. And all God's children said, amen. As we come into this time of communion, I want us to remember that the battles that are fought here in this place, out there in the community, on behalf of all of you, the staff that we have here, the ministers, we thank you for being able to do God's work in this place and continue his mission of bringing all people to know the name of the Lord. Let's pray. Father, you continue to shower us with your blessings, and I pray that what we have to offer you in this time of worship is pleasing. And God, if it can, it strains us a bit to draw us near to you. Thank you for the opportunity to serve you and to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Morning, church. How is everyone this morning? Good. Good. I'm doing fine.
Words and stuff. There it is. Oh, my goodness. This looks delicious. I've been looking forward to this for like 12 hours already.
Yeah.
Here, you go first. You know what? I didn't bring forks.
I'll eat with my hands.
That's what I'll do, too.
Yeah.
Hey, where's, hi, good morning, everyone. There he is. Bill. Happy birthday, man.
Happy birthday, Bill.
Woo!
I never work on my birthday either, so
that's
I don't
true.
Blame him.
That's true. I kind of really want, hey, Joe, can you go get me a fork? Thanks, man.
Can I have some?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Can you waddle faster? You're lucky you're cute.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, welcome to our final week of the C&D Buffet. We hope that you have enjoyed all of this delicious food as much as we have over the last couple weeks. Oh, that's because you didn't get any. That's right. That's right. But we wanted to end on a really delicious note. This is the end of our series. Next week we have Sent to Serve, and then after that, Bill's back, and we're excited about that. Wow, look at that. Ooh, thanks, sir. Look at.
There's pepperoni in this lasagna, y'all.
And Italian sausage.
And Italian sausage.
Yeah, it was made for men.
Amen to that.
We want to end on something absolute. There it is. Look, he got here fast enough in time for me to have a fork. Here, you can. I asked.
But he didn't bring a plate for himself for lasagna. Joe is a very literal servant.
Here. You go ahead and start eating because you talk more than me. So this is
sure.
Your chance to get food. I'm going to watch you eat it, though. Oh, so good. So good. Yeah, so we want to end on something delicious. So we are ending the series on my best dish, my lasagna. And if you know, you know. And if you were at IF Gathering 2 years ago, you know. That's delicious.
Good job.
Thanks, man.
So.
I can't wait till Joe brings me a fork.
No, you can use mine if you want. Like Drew said, over the last month, we have commandeered this facility and this stage, and we are happy to bring you a sermon series of just very eclectic dishes.
Thanks, man.
And a variety of things, but we realize that our thoughts are singular. They're pushing in a certain direction, and that's equipping all of you and reminding ourselves of who our God is and what we're capable of in this world. The first week we talked about temperaments, the four types of temperaments, how to speak into each other, and how to listen to each other with these temperaments. We divided into sections. I have my, this isn't really my main color, but it's Superman blue, so I like it a lot. The second week, Drew spoke on heroes and stories, about how we are the hero of the gospel story, that Jesus came to rescue us and guide us. Then he went on and shifted into the story of the church, the story that we are living out now, that we are the guides and the hero of the story are the lost of God. We have equipped you to speak. We have shown you who to seek, and we have reminded ourselves who we are. Now we must be prepared for battle. We must suit up with the suit of armor that God has provided each and every one of us. This is not only for our defense, but for our offense. Make no mistake, church, we are in a spiritual battle, not just with the forces in the world, but with ourselves. We are Satan's favorite target. 1 Peter 5:8 says, "Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour." But there's hope. God has equipped us. Ephesians 6:10-13. "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand." The battles we fight of the Spirit will require and task us of all our energy, physically, spiritually, mentally. We've all been in these battles, church, some of us recently and now, where Satan is poised to take us down. And at some point, our physical strength, our mental strength, and even our spiritual strength will be depleted. And that's when he finds us to be the perfect target. But again, there's hope. God has equipped us with his armor, his spiritual armor. And this fire that we sometimes lose inside of us, Jesus' fire burns ever hotter. But we have to understand what we're equipped with. There's a scene in Lord of the Rings at the end of the third movie where Aragorn, he's kind of the side hero. He's been struggling with identity. He's been walking and running for 13 months, chasing the evil ones. He's been doing battle. He's battle fatigued. He's mentally drained. And he comes almost to the end of this battle, slashing his sword for the last time. And he kind of buckles his knees as if, I don't have anything left to give. I'm done. I might as well just lay on the ground and give up everything. But he grips hold of his sword and he finds himself again. He anchors himself, grabs a hold of his hilt, and continues on in battle. This is what God is encouraging us with, church. This spiritual armor. When our fire goes out, the fire of the Spirit given by Christ is an unquenching fire that cannot be extinguished.
So Paul gives us a breakdown of this armor. He says, starting in verse 14, "Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes with the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God." So we're going to break down these pieces of armor for the next few minutes. The first one is the belt of truth. Now, it's a belt because the belt actually holds the uniform together. When they have the shirt tucked in, they pull up the skirt or thing or whatever. That was fun. Ooh, remember, I'm fat man. Yeah, okay. So it's the truth, the belt of truth. It's the truth that holds the armor together. And it's not just any truth. It's God's truth. The problem is, we as humans, we don't really like truth. We like to be right. And it doesn't matter if truth is truthful or not, we just want to be right, and we will take in anything that affirms our own rightness. I was actually watching a couple nights ago Stephen Colbert, a clip from the Stephen Colbert Report, and there's a segment where he comes up with a word and does a bunch of jokes about this word, but the word that actually came up was truthiness. So he talks about truthiness, and what truthiness means to Stephen Colbert, it's that believing something that feels true. It's believing in something that feels true, even if it isn't supported by fact. There's a lot of people in the world, and there's a lot of Christians who believe something just because it feels good or it makes them feel better, but it's not the real truth. We call that deception. So here's what I want you to know about the belt of truth, God's truth. It's not going to lead you astray. It's not going to lead you down a wrong road. There is security and comfort in the belt of truth, because you don't have to look at God's truth and question if it's going to lead you down a bad road. God's word, even if it's difficult, will always lead you down the right path. You can trust it. Our own thinking gets us down the wrong path, and we do it real fast. because we keep choosing the wrong paths. But it's God's truth that puts us back on the right path. Psalm 25:5 says, "Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God my Savior, and all my hope is in you all day long." So here's the thing. The Bible refers to God as the Father of all truth. The Bible also refers to the devil, Satan, the enemy, as the father of lies. My question to you is this. Who's your daddy?
Paul continues on with the breastplate of righteousness. So that we have to remember the time period here, which Paul is speaking into the church. This is a time when Rome was occupying everything, everywhere. Roman soldiers marching down the streets, breaking in doors, holding unjust courts, imprisoning the people. So Paul speaks into something that they can see and understand. But he wants us to understand how different God's armor is from the everyday armor of the world. The breastplate of righteousness. This is one of my favorites. A breastplate was vital to protect the organs of the body. This was something that went down over and behind to protect your heart, your lungs, your kidneys, your stomach. That's where the kill zone was for these soldiers, and they had to protect this area. But I want to focus on the heart, protecting the heart, because that's vital. Our hearts can be deceived by the world, and they will be deceived by Satan. So is this my righteousness that I'm leaning on? Absolutely not. I have barely enough righteousness to fill a thimble. Isaiah 64:6 says, "All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away." But God. Here Paul is speaking to the righteousness of Jesus Christ in this breastplate piece. The righteousness that we hold on to is that of Jesus's through his crucifixion and resurrection. This is what we cling to. Because we know that Satan's going to come at us with, "Well, I can't be good enough for God. I've just come out of this sin, and I can't pull myself up. I'll never make it. God's grace can't be enough for what I've done." These questions ring out in our minds. But Jesus is that answer to all of our questions, in which the devil has no hold. Matthew 5:6. "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied." What are we thirsty for, church? Are we thirsty for the righteousness of Jesus? Because our own isn't enough. And in order to protect our hearts, our vital organs, we have to be thirsty for the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Romans 3:22 says, "This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile."
So, my breastplate of righteousness. Now, what's going to be really funny is this.
Oh.
All week, I told him I was going to wear Superman. And then I decided, no, I'm going to go for a real hero.
That stings hard.
Next is the boots of peace. Now, when we think about peace, we usually think about like tranquility and no conflict and those kind of things. But that's not really what peace fully is. When we look at peace, peace is stability. Peace is stability, which is fitting to have as shoes for feet, because it's feet and shoes that help you stay stable, that keep you balanced, that don't help you trip up when you're walking, It's everything that keeps you stable, and peace does the same thing. Now, here's the thing about peace, though, is it's all about stability. So we're not saying that peace gets rid of every struggle in your life. Peace doesn't get rid of any conflict that's in your soul. Peace doesn't really remove anxiety. Here's what peace is. Peace is when life hits you hard, when it starts knocking you over, when it throws thing after thing after thing after you, that you get to remain standing. It doesn't remove conflict, but peace allows you stability. Because it's not just your peace, because our peace is all over the place. Like, we can have peace in 5 minutes, and then, like, you know, 20 minutes later, something happened, and we no longer have peace. Our peace of stability is God's peace. It's the peace that goes beyond, as Paul writes in Philippians, peace that is beyond all understanding. That when the world looks at all the stuff that's happening, and they look at us as Christians, and they say, how come you haven't faltered? It's because you say, my peace is in God. That's what real biblical peace is. Real biblical peace is having stability in times of struggle.
Next, we have the shield of faith. I want to start with Romans 10:17. Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. This is the shield of faith that we carry. This is the shield that protects us from Satan's attacks. And what's interesting about a shield, it is one of the early forms of defense in this world. Now, the shield protected from the volley of arrows from afar. The shield protects in close combat from the sword or spear. The shield is also an extension of our reach. It can reach farther than we can. The shield can also be used for offense if needed. Throughout the centuries of war, man has evolved the shield to meet the needs of the battle. We have put our faith in God the Father, Jesus, his Son, and the Holy Spirit from which he sent. Our protection comes from the Lord. We as believers must also continue to grow our faith to help equip us in the battles that come in the present day.
Next, we have the helmet of salvation. We haven't tested this one out yet, Dave, so we'll see how this goes. Oh, yeah, that's good. We still good? We still hearable? Perfect. The helmet of salvation. Now, when I think of salvation, I ultimately think of freedom. As a youth minister who works at summer camp, when we have pool time, there's always a game that ends up being played during pool time, and that's a game called Dunk the Staff. It's an unofficial game, and you don't even know you're playing until next thing you know, all these teams are on top of you trying to dunk you, and you're like moving them away and pushing away, and sometimes you give them the people's elbow, and you just make it look like an accident. But there was one time specifically, this was years and years and years ago, where I was playing water basketball, like basketball in the water. And next thing I know, like these like group of teens just swarm me and yank me underwater before I'm even able to take a breath before going down. So I'm underwater, I have no air, and I'm trying to flail, and like it's not happening because there's like 5 or 6 teens who are holding me down, and I'm just like, this is it, this is how I die. Like tomorrow it's gonna be in the newspapers, youth minister drowned by teens. Like it's gonna be great. And like, and this feels like, honestly, it may have been like 5 to 10 seconds, but when you have no air underwater, like it's an eternity. Like it just feels like it's not going to end. And finally they let me go, and you do like the push up from the floor to jump into the air as high as you can and get that initial life back into you, right? That to me is salvation.
That is freedom. And it's not, when we talk about it on a spiritual level, it's obviously dealing with sin in our lives. Because sin, even if it doesn't feel like it, even if it feels fun and it feels good and it fulfills you for a moment, sin is ultimately drowning you. And what the helmet of salvation provides is protection from the penalty of sin. Sin, of course, is separation from God. The helmet of salvation, when you choose Jesus to be your Lord, to be the person who guides your life, and to be your Savior, the one, the only one who can remove sin from your life, when you do that and you put on the helmet of salvation, you receive freedom. Freedom from your past, the things that held you back, your own past struggles and mistakes, baggage, family baggage, past trauma, all those things, Jesus looks at it and goes, it doesn't matter anymore. You're with me. There's freedom from the present. It's not just past sin, but sin is still a problem now. But when it comes to the helmet of salvation, we are freed from the present because instead of letting sin guide our decisions, we let the Holy Spirit guide our decisions. And I can't believe, like, how many Christians I hear the phrase, I just can't help myself, or I just can't stop myself. And I think, you can, you got the Holy Spirit. Like, one of the things I teach teens is if you and a significant other are in a room together, and, you know, if it's a guy and a girl, and, you know, magic happens because they're teens and hormones are going, you can actually help yourself from that. If you are a person, you say, hey, I have every STD in the world, and my dad just got out of prison for killing a guy, and he's going to be home in 2 minutes, you'll be able to say, oh, I can't stop. I can totally stop myself. As a Christian, we have the Holy Spirit who guides us. And then finally, we're free from the future. Because as people who are distanced from God, the future is hell. But if you choose Jesus, he frees us from that future. He frees us to eternity without struggle, without tears, without pain, without anything that causes you grief. All of that will be gone. You will be free. And as Jesus says in John chapter 8, whoever the Son sets free, they are free indeed. Salvation is freedom.
This is going to be my favorite. The sword. The sword of the Spirit. So let's start out on the right path. We are in a spiritual battle. And I'm not asking the Holy Spirit to borrow his sword. My sword is the Holy Spirit.
Oh, I got this one, Curtis.
Yeah.
The sword of the Spirit, ladies and gentlemen. The Holy Spirit, who is sent from God in Jesus' name. The Spirit is my guide, my wordsmith. I am to follow the Spirit as the Spirit dwells in me. Have you ever noticed that when a warrior stands poised for battle, holding the sword, it's not sheathed, it's not drooping at his side, it's pointed, pointed straight ahead in our repertoire. Everything else is for defense. The sword is the offense. John 6:63 says, the Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of the Spirit and life. This sword is life-giving, meaning the Word of God is life-giving. My favorite verse in Scripture, I even got a tattoo on my arm because of it, is Matthew 10:34. When Jesus sends his disciples out into the towns to testify and witness and teach, he tells them, do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to this world, for I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. The sword of the Spirit. which we hold as the life-giving words of God from God, spoken to those who are living in spiritual death. How sharp is your sword, and is it poised and ready?
Oh, I just remembered a thing. The Holy Spirit doesn't, or the armor of God doesn't have pants.
Whoa. That's not this kind of sermon.
Oh, my bad.
No.
Oh, my bad.
Keep our pants on.
Okay, I'll do that. Sure. So how do I look?
Absolutely ridiculous.
It's the Batman shirt, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the focal point, but okay. That's absurd, man.
Okay.
So, what do you... Just metaphorically, or what are we talking about here?
Yeah, I think this is honestly what most people think of the armor of God, actually. Like, most
if they
people,
know anything at all.
Do what?
If they know anything at all.
If they know anything at all, yeah, for sure. They just kind of look at this and they go, all right, well, this is the armor of God. This will get me through. And they kind of forget, honestly, that we're in war. Like, this is not going to get you anywhere, war. So what could get you in war?
What?
I said, what can we, what do we actually need for war?
We need a real suit of armor.
That's right. So, I can't see. We need legit armor. We need legit armor because we are actually in war. Now, of course, this is medieval armor. They didn't have this in Bible times, but you get the point. Like, they're fully suited up. They're fully ready to go at it. Like, if you can imagine, we really wanted this, but we couldn't make it happen. Like, this is like Dave Gehring ready to step forward into battle. Like, it is strong. It is tough. It is ready to go against the devil and what he's fighting and what he's about. It is everything that we need in order to make it through this world. Is this tough, strong armor. God doesn't give us crap. God gives us strong things for us to make it through this world. And we need to put on this kind of armor to make it through. Now, how does this armor actually work? Well, we look at the last part, Ephesians 6, verse 18. And it says, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions, with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all of the Lord's people. So there's two things I see here. The first one is that the Holy Spirit, or the armor, is empowered by prayer. Now, I'm not just, like, not just prayer in general. It's not just like, oh, God, thank you for the food, and then your armor goes, ching, you know, it's not like that. What is actually behind the prayer is connection to God. If your connection to God is weak, the armor is going to be weak. If your connection to God is faulty, your armor is going to be faulty. Now, of looking at people who are struggling with a type of sin and saying, well, that's their sin, they'll deal with it. That's not what Christians are all about. We challenge each other to build each other up, to make each other stronger, to make each other better Christians, so we can go to war together. Back in the Greek times, there was the Spartans came up with this formation called the phalanx. And what it is all the soldiers were gathered together, lock their shields next to each other and above each other, and it was basically this big, moving, impenetrable force. But if one soldier did not lock their shield or walked out of step, the whole thing crumbled. Because if one person went down, the whole phalanx is wide open to crumble. They had to work together in unison. And that's how the church should be doing. We should be connected. We should be marching forward together. See, we are at a war. The armor of God is not just a good idea. It's necessity. We need it. Dark forces are at work in this world, and it's up to us to keep it at bay. We need each other. So lean on each other.
Lean on God. Let's go to war. So get on your feet. Get up now. Arise. Arise, Christians of Columbiana. We want to end this moment in defiance. We want to end this series in defiance. Because Satan is not stopping. He doesn't take breaks. He doesn't cool down. He's constantly going. And it takes us to go out and to do God's work to keep him at bay. We are at war. So we want to end in defiance. Defiance against Satan, defiance against the enemy, defiance against all that, and lean in on Jesus to make this war end. So arise. Arise, Christians of Columbiana. Spears will be shaken. Swords will be splintered. It will be a sore day, a red day, but the sun rises. Sound the war horn.
Let's sing this song.
In heavenly armor we'll enter the land. The battle belongs to the Lord. No weapon that's fashioned against us will stand. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. When the power of darkness comes in like a flood, the battle belongs to the Lord. He's raised up a standard, the power of his blood. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. When your enemy presses in hard, do not fear. The battle belongs to the Lord. Take courage, my friend, your redemption is near. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord.
God, thank you so much for empowering us and equipping us with your armor. God, we take charge of this very seriously. Continue to give us strength and perseverance as we go out and do the battles that you have put in place for each and every one of us and as a church. God, may your name ring throughout the land victoriously, and may we always continue to serve you and give you glory. Give us strength this day, Lord, to move forward and show everybody how Jesus changes everything. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. What do we say in this house, church? Jesus changes everything. Have a great week.